Good morning. Welcome to worship at Baptist Temple. We're so glad that you're here this morning. We're glad that you have chosen to take this hour of this Sunday morning to spend it with us here in the sanctuary, committing yourself to this 1 hour of focusing your mind's attention and your heart's affection on God Himself. We're glad that you've chosen to meet with other believers in Christ for worship, for study, for prayer, for fellowship. May you leave this hour better connected to God and better connected to each other. God, you alone will satisfy our longing. We wait, O God, for you alone. We survive by our faith that fears and tombs and tribulations are preludes to eternal life. We wait, O God, for you alone. We wait, hoping to meet you in our gardens of sorrow as you met Mary. We wait for you to come to us behind locked doors of fear as you came to the disciples. We wait, O God, for you alone. Soon enough, we will walk to the tombs again and discover resurrection, learning that if weeping endures for a night, joy comes in the morning. We wait, O God, for you alone. And when the morning finally comes, its light is ever more brilliant as we remember how you carried us in the night. We wait, O God, for you alone. Amen.
Join me in prayer. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, Creator of all things, visible and invisible, you who through Jesus Christ have made the worlds and through Him redeemed us, and through Him sent us your Spirit to transform us, we give you thanks and praise for these moments of worship together. Oh Lord God, we represent before you many needs of body, mind, and spirit, And so we pray for your healing, your restoration, your mercy, and your forgiveness. Lord, we pray that you would give us a deeper experience of your presence. In these moments of worship, and as we leave this place as well, that we might, because of your power and presence, because of the example of Christ and the fullness of the Spirit, serve you more faithfully in the world. Lord, we offer ourselves up to you. We ask you to transform our hearts and minds. Speak to us. Correct us. Rebuke us. Change us. And lead us, we pray, without failing or fainting in the ways of life everlasting. We ask it, Father, in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our New Testament lesson is found in Philippians chapter 3. I want to begin reading with verse 12 through chapter 4, verse 1. Paul is considering his deeply held aspiration to know Christ and to know him fully. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I've made it my own yet or reached my goal, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us then who are mature be of the same mind, and if you think differently about anything, this too God will reveal to you. Only let us hold fast to what we have attained. Brothers and sisters, join in imitating me and observe those who live according to the example you have in us, for many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. I've often told you of them, and now I tell you even with tears. Their end is destruction. Their God is the belly. Their glory is in their shame. Their minds are set on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven. It is from there that we are expecting a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. He will transform the body of our humiliation that it may be conformed to the body of his glory by the power that also enables him to make all things subject to himself. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love, my joy and my crown, so stand firm in the Lord, my beloved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We know that all that we have comes from God, and it is as an act of worship and with joyful hearts and out of an abundance of riches that we return to God a portion of that with which he has blessed us. We do so here at Baptist Temple by giving our tithes and our offerings here to the work of Christ at this church, and we invite you to join us in that act of worship. We provided five ways for you to give: in person, by mail, by text message, through our website, and also through the new Baptist Temple mobile app. However you choose to give, give generously. More importantly, give as God leads you. And now, as we prepare for this time of giving, we sing a hymn together that echoes the words of the New Testament lesson. The hymn is number 584, My Faith Has Found a Resting Place. Would you stand with me as we sing?
Trust me, I am living God. He is Lord. Please join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we're just so thankful for this day and this opportunity to be here at Baptist Temple this morning and worship you. We're so thankful for this congregation, and we're so thankful for the community that we live in. We pray that you'll use this offering that we're about to, that you're about to receive, for your will, to grow your kingdom here at Baptist Temple, here in the Heights, and in Houston, and all over the world. Just pray that you'll be with those in our church that are unable to be here today due to traveling or sickness, other things that are going on, just unable to come, and pray that you'll be with them and bless them, touch their hearts and lives, and let them know that you're there for them, that we're there for them. Thank you again, Lord, just for the opportunity to worship you right here. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you.
Do you think people in our day and age believe in the future? Well, that's probably too vague a way of putting it. Do you think people in our day and age believe in a future ordained by God that involves the restoration of heaven and earth and the repair, healing, and restoration of all things? In one of the first Christian sermons found in the book of Acts, Peter refers to something that's called the restoration of all things. He refers to Christ, who's been crucified, raised from the dead, exalted, ascended to the right hand of the Father. And he says that Christ is one whom heaven must receive. This is sermon has happened shortly after the ascension of Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the times of the restoration of all things. It's a phrase, couple of words in Greek, but in that shorthand way, it refers, drawing upon some Old Testament language, it refers to the fulfillment of what could be called the story of Scripture. The story of Scripture is quite simple. You've heard me summarize it before. It's a good creation. God creates the man and the woman, puts them in charge of things, and they are to offer him the worship that he is due. They will enjoy his presence. They are to take charge of his creation. They are to be fruitful and multiply and extend the frontiers of God's dominion throughout the earth. They are the agents of his sovereignty, of his rule. But of course, we know the story. They rebel. They want to be like God. They don't want to be his image bearers. They want to be God themselves and take charge of their own lives. That sets in motion it's not to be understood as a kind of psychological story of everyone. That is, I go through this fall for myself and you go through it for yourself. No, it's actually understood as a grand historical narrative, as something that actually happened and forever changed the world, so that the world is no longer endowed with the intimacy of God's presence. God is present, but no longer the closeness and the face-to-face nature of God's presence. And in fact, the world and its human creatures no longer enjoy the grandeur of immortal life in the presence of God. No, the world has fallen, is the theological term, or the world is now subject to corruption and decay. There is a curse placed on the created order. This is referred to not only in Genesis, but Paul refers to it, for example, in Romans chapter 8, when he says the creation itself is groaning and waiting for its day of redemption, its day of liberation from the curse of corruption. It's a story that's found in Jewish literature for as far back as we can reach and know. It's a story that indicates that one day God will not only, that one day God will restore all the earth. He's using Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. He's using the nation Israel. Israel is his servant. Israel is his people. Israel is the agency through which the work of Adam and Eve is now, though it is broken and ruptured and fallen, that work is now to be a work of redemption through Israel, through Israel's servant, and finally through a coming anointed king, the world can be restored. And so the prophets anticipated. Israel has failed in some respects, but the Lord is faithful. The Lord has promised. The Lord is going to redeem the world through Jesus Christ. And so Paul alludes to this same kind of story. It's found right at the very end of Philippians 3, the passage that we read together, when Paul says our citizenship, he's ironically and maybe even slightly pejoratively referring to the Roman citizenship that some of the Philippians have. Our citizenship, real citizenship, is from heaven, from which we await the restoration of all things, the return of Christ, from which we await a Savior who will rescue us from this present evil age. The Lord Jesus Christ, who will at his coming transform these humiliated, mortal, corrupt bodies into conformity with the glory, with the body of his resurrection glory. And he will do that as Lord of the universe by the power that he has to subject not just our broken bodies and transform them into his glory, but by the power that he has to subject the all things. He's referring to the entire created order. All things is a Pauline term used in various places to mean all things visible and invisible. Colossians 1, 15 to 20. Things that are corrupt and broken. By the power that he has to restore all things, to subjugate all things to himself. There's this narrative, this story, this expectation. Do you think people in our day and age really believe that one day God will restore the world, heaven and earth? He will, and all things in it, all human beings, and will one day set things right. Sometimes setting things right means having to deal with your enemies, and that's also promised that those who absolutely refuse the mercies of God revealed through Jesus Christ will also be subjugated in a way perhaps they won't like. But Paul in Philippians 2 has already told us that Christ was obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore God exalted him and bestowed on him the name Lord, which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow. One day of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. The world will be put right. And even if some people will have to say so, you might say unwillingly or almost too late, nonetheless, the entire created order will be restored. And God will receive the worship that he alone is due through Jesus Christ. And so Paul, when he comes to the conclusion of what he wants to say in Philippians, he warns the Philippians to beware of some false teachers. He has been hounded by them throughout his missionary teaching, and they come behind him and they detract from the work of Christ. He points to the fact that he has had a lot of human prestige and a lot of Jewish authority and Jewish prestige and power and influence and no doubt money. And yet all those things, he says, were that used to be gain to him compared to the surpassing value of knowing Christ, whom he met on the road to Damascus, all these things are now nothing better than a debit in his ledger of life compared to knowing Christ. He says that he longs to know Christ. He longs to be in the presence of Christ. He longs to know him intimately. He longs to know not only the power of his resurrection, but even here and now he wants to know the power of Christ's resurrection, so that if that means being in having a fellowship with his sufferings in prison, suffering hardship and cold and hunger, and suffering the abuse that he has physically suffered in his life, if that means being so conformed, if having the power of Christ's resurrection means that he'll have to first go through this conformity to the sufferings of Christ, he wants it because he wants to know Christ. He wants to know him fully. He wants to know the fullness of the resurrection. And he says, if I have to die, then that means I will know the resurrection not just when Christ returns, but I'll know the resurrection out of the realm of the dead. He'll have a from the dead resurrection. And then our passage 3:12 picks up. The imagery shifts. The theme is the same, but the imagery begins to shift because now he pictures something that the Philippians would have been very familiar with, something that we would have called the Olympic Games. There were various kinds of games: Olympic Games, Corinthian Games, Isthmian Games. But these were tended to be boxing and track and field and running and jumping and throwing things and so on. But running was at the heart of these games, various distances. And so Paul changes the picture here. And now he says of 3:12, not that I have already reached the resurrection. He wants to experience knowing Christ, but not that I fully have experienced it yet. And he changes the metaphor. But he says, even though I have not fully experienced it in 3:12, he says, or have already become fully completed, meaning fully known Christ, but I press on. And it's the picture of a runner who continues the race. The translations, understandably, have different... The words are a little confusing at times for translation's sake, but there's no doubt as to the overall picture here. It's the picture, and even though the grammar is a little convoluted, it's the picture of a runner. And in this case, Paul refers to himself as the runner. And he says at one point in his life, he was running, but Christ overtook him. He's thinking of the road to Damascus. He was overtaken by Christ. And grabbed, you might say, laid hold of by Christ. And now he is running the race so that he can overtake the purpose for which Christ overtook him, which is completion, knowing Christ, resurrection glory. And so what he does is he's not going to look like any good runner. He doesn't look to the side. He doesn't look at who may be gaining on him, but forgetting what lies behind, in reaching forward, straining every muscle to what lies ahead, he presses on toward the prize of the upward heavenly summons, the call of God in Christ Jesus. It's the picture of a race. He says he hasn't finished the race yet. He says he's not going to stop running. In fact, if anything, at this point in his life, near death, certainly in prison, hoping to be released, but has had several brushes with death and could well die in prison, as tradition says he did. In fact, was beheaded just outside the city of Rome at some point within a few years. He's pressing forward so that he can know Christ. Running the race. It's the future. It's the prize. It's finishing, it's hitting the finish line. It's collapsing, you might say, into the arms of Christ himself who comes to meet him. It's being part of the new creation for which he longs. The future has energized Paul's experience of the present, and he's not going to stop. I want you to see a little video. A couple of weeks ago was sent a video by a friend, and the title that the video was given was Don't Give Up. That subtitle refers to the person, you might say, who was in second place and in the end ended up winning. Better the title would be is Don't Stop the Race. Don't quit. Finish strong. It's the beginning of football season. I promise you, before the season is over, you're going to see somebody with ball in hand, a clear goal line in front of them, racing forward, and they'll start cheering or taunting or high-stepping, and someone will come up behind them and slap the ball out of their hand. Or they'll forget where the goal line is. You've seen that before, too, and spike the ball on the 5-yard line. Paul's in prison. He's thinking of himself as a runner. He's thinking of the prize in front of him. And he's straining. I press forward. There's effort. He's accompanied by the power of God's Spirit. He's accompanied by the power of the resurrection. The power of the resurrection is not only something that's experienced on the last day, but there are a few passages. Ephesians 1, 19 and 20 would be one place, 2 Corinthians 3:3, I think it is, where resurrection power is also available here and now to the believer. Usually Paul, when he says that, he's referring to the work of the Spirit. So another way to think of it is, whenever Paul refers to the power of the Spirit working in us now, it's the resurrection power of God getting revved up already to transform us into the likeness of Christ. The fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5 is transforming us. It's shaping within us these outcomes of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, goodness, self-control. This, the resurrection power of God is at work. Or Romans chapter 6, Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us who were baptized into Christ, into union with Christ, we were baptized into his death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead to the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life." We're identified with the crucified, buried, and risen Jesus, so that the energy of God conveyed to us by His Spirit is being ramped up in anticipation of our final resurrection. We are internally being transformed. 2 Corinthians 4, verses 16, Paul says, "For momentary light affliction, the sufferings of this present age," present tense, "is producing an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison, while we look not at the things that are seen, but things that are unseen. The things that are seen are provisional, temporary. The things of the new creation are everlasting and eternal." God is already working in us through the power of the Spirit, through the power that's in the world because of the resurrection of Jesus. God is already at work in us to transform us into the likeness of Christ. Notice just a couple of things. He says, forgetting what lies behind. What's he referring to? Does that mean developing an amnesia and don't even think about the past? No, history's good. Memories are great. Paul remembers in this very book, the Philippians, he says, "I thank my God upon my every remembrance of you, always offering prayer with thanksgiving in my every prayer for you all." So he thinks of the Philippians. He remembers them. He has good memories. He's thankful for what they have done and what they continue to do in sending gifts of support and money to him. So he's not thinking that forgetting what lies behind in terms of a blanket forgetting. He's referring to laying aside those things that he used to take great pride in, that he referred to above, which ultimately, he says, are loss compared to the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus the Lord. There's so many things that we place great store by, and they can be good things. Family and food and shelter and money and the ability to be protected and safe and to have our homes. All of those are good things, but good things, when they become good things that are second things, can become demonic when they are placed as first things. Our Lord tells us in the Sermon on the Mount that we should lay not up for ourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroy, thieves cannot break in and steal. He says, don't be anxious for tomorrow, saying, "What shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or with what shall we clothe ourselves?" Consider the lilies of the field, the birds of the air. The Father knows them and cares for them and arrays them with beauty and protection. Don't you think He cares for you, O you of little faith? The point is not that these things aren't good. They're provided by the Father. They are good things, but they are not our ultimate and final possession. We idolize these things when we make them our supreme good. The supreme good in this passage for Paul is knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. There are lots of good things that we have for which we give thanks, and we are called to be stewards over these good things so that they may be instruments of extending the reign of God through the earth, forgetting what lies behind. Notice one more phrase I call your attention to. He strains forward. It involves, I press forward in order that I may lay hold of or grasp. It's actually literally the word for overtake. I may overtake that for which I was overtaken by Christ. Fellow Christians, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet. But this one thing I do, forgetting those things that I used to take great pride in, reaching forward to what lies ahead, the future, our world, and we need to remember we have a future. You know, the practice is known as transhumanism. This is the attempt to, using quantum computing and robotic parts to go beyond, go in what's called post-humanism. It's a new stage, so the modern world is calling it, a new stage of evolution whereby human bodies and mechanical bodies, by the aid of technology and quantum computing, now enter into a new stage of humanity. It's as if we're afraid to die, as if we don't have any confidence in what will happen following death or following the end of this present evil age. There is a future for the people of God. There is a future whereby one day God will put all these things right. There's so many injustices in the world, the racism, the power plays, the abuse of people, the violence. Listen, God puts it within our hearts to be angry at these things and to be upset and frustrated at them, and we should be. But we can never lose confidence that one day God will set these things right. There are so many injustices. You know, we just need to take a break sometimes from watching the news and a break from all the media that do nothing but give us the constant stirring. Good news doesn't sell. And so everything that's troubling is what gets told to us, and we feed on it. There are frustrations. But listen, one day God will set the world right. They will beat their swords into plowshares. Neither will they study war anymore. And Christ the King will rule and reign. The kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of our God. The Hallelujah chorus is based on Revelation, the last few verses of Revelation 11. The kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of our God in His Christ, and He shall reign forever and ever. And the heavenly chorus will shout and sing, Hallelujah, worthy art Thou to receive honor and glory and praise and dominion, for Thou hast created all things, O Lord God. And then to Christ, for Thou hast redeemed all things and redeemed people from every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and has made them to be priests to our God. Adam and Eve were to be priests to God, and now all those who know God through Jesus Christ become priests who will serve God in a transformed world. That's why Paul says, for example, in verse 3:3, for we are the people of God, the circumcision, who serve in the Spirit of God and glory in God and put no confidence in the old order. One day, this world will come to its dramatic conclusion when Christ comes, and he will set things right. He will separate, as the book of as Matthew says, sheep from the goats. There'll be a great day of judgment and separation, and God will set things right and restore His people who have suffered for the cause of Christ. But here's what Paul says he does. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call. I want to emphasize the word call. Call of God in Christ Jesus. The Christian life is referred to as a summons, as our calling. The call of God. Call is, Paul, God is summoning us to the end, to the finish line, to the story of the Bible. Spoiler alert, it's a happy ending. A resurrection from the dead, the restoration of all things through Jesus Christ. And we can take energy and perspective and focus. As terrible as things may be here and now, we're going to be transformed and participate in a transformed creation as with resurrection bodies under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. We have been called, summoned to that. Life is a call. Paul says this sort of thing in other places, 2 Thessalonians 1:11, 1 Corinthians 1:26. Life is a call or a calling. It has purpose. We have been summoned. What are our purposes? Our purposes are as varied as our giftedness, but they are as singular as the work of God through Christ. God has a purpose to transform the world and to conform it to His glory through the person of Jesus Christ, and we have been called to be His agents in the world. Don't ever think of the Christian faith as a little add-on to whatever else it is you want to do. The Christian faith is our calling, and it shapes everything we are, everything we have, and everything we do. So press on. Don't give in. Don't give up. Paul says, he tells us weeping that there are some who did fall by the wayside, who made their appetites, who were afraid of the cross. They became enemies of the cross. They didn't want to suffer. They couldn't persevere in the face of suffering. But he says, we have citizenship, verse 20, a real citizenship, not the Roman citizenship. Our citizenship is in heaven, from which we eagerly await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform. That's a word, it's by the power of God, utterly remake, who will transform the bodies of our humble estate, our shabby bodies of weakness and humiliation, into conformity with the body of his resurrection glory by the power that he has to subject all things to himself. Friends, don't give in. Don't give up. Rejoice in the Lord. Press on toward the prize. Your life has been shaped by God through Christ, and now God longs for us to be a people who are salt and light in the world to do his work under the lordship of Jesus Christ. Lord, help us to be faithful to you. Remind us of the calling that we have in Christ. Shape our hearts and minds so that even in the hour of suffering and sickness, frustration, and the evils around us in our world, we can nonetheless experience the power of your resurrection, even as we experience the fellowship of your sufferings, being conformed to your image. Oh Lord, help us to run the race, not give in, not to cheer too quickly, but to finish the race with faith, with strength, with discipline and perseverance, knowing that you've summoned us and called us. You've already apprehended us, taken hold of us, and overtaken us. We love you and we devote ourselves to you and ask you to transform us through Jesus Christ and enable us by your power to serve. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Indeed, we have all heard from God today, either through directly from his word, through our pastor's message, through a hymn. In some way, we have heard from God. And so, because of that, we all must respond. Our hymn is number 361, My Jesus, I Love Thee. Let's stand together as we sing.
At the end of Jude, this beautiful benediction. Now to him who is able to keep us from stumbling and to cause us to stand blameless before his throne with great joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to him be glory, majesty, dominion, power, before all time, now and forevermore. Amen.